American corn farmers, a proud and chosen profession inspired through generations. Tested, resilient, and committed to giving back as much as they're growing. Pushing the boundaries of what's possible with every bushel, while replenishing every increasingly precious resource, like the reduction of soil loss by 40% with every acre grown. In a world where sustainability matters more than ever, we need all the help we can get. And there's no greater resource than the capable hands of American corn farmers.
On a cold February morning in Indianapolis, Tony Caritsas woke up, got dressed, loaded his sawed-off shotgun, and drove to his bank. He wasn't there to steal anything. He was there to take his life back. American Hostage is a new podcast starring me, John Hamm, that tells the true story of one man who channeled the rage of a nation and took justice into his own hands. Follow American Hostage wherever you get your podcasts, or you can binge all 8 episodes right now on Amazon Music or Wondery Plus.
Pro Football Focus analyzes every play of every game to deliver in-depth grades on college football, the NFL, and more. Our weekly conversation with Pro Football Focus is presented by Renewal Aesthetics and Sexual Wellness. PFF on the Bill Riley Show starts now.
Well, it actually started like a half hour ago. We had Anthony Tresh on to talk about his way too early top 25. This is kind of the PFF hour here today. On the Bill Riley Show. Normally, Seth Galina joins us at 1:05 Mountain Time, 3:05 Montreal Daylight Time. But today, he's asked to go a little bit earlier. Must mean that he's got to go out to the market or something like that and fetch his Cheez-Its or go have a nice lunch at a cafe in the old part of Montreal. I don't know. But he's on with us a bit earlier today, making this the PFF Hour, the PFF Power Hour here on ESPN 700. We will not be talking about college football per se, but some draft stuff today with Seth Galina. How are you?
I'm great. I saw that my man Tony had Wake Forest in his top 10, or like number 10. Did you guys talk about that?
We didn't talk about Wake Forest. I took him to task a little bit on having USC at number 8. I mean, that's like the ultimate... You know, hitting the ceiling with 14 transfers in the transfer report. Now, we were happy Utah was at 7, but SC at 8 was a bit high. Wake Forest at 10 was a little surprising, but at least they've had some success in recent years.
Yeah, I mean, I have nothing to say yet. I have no takes yet because I haven't, you know, me and Tony are putting together the College Football Preview magazine. And I've been doing so much draft stuff, but I haven't gotten around to it yet. I'm going to spend all of May doing that. So I'm not ready for any hot takes on Wake Forest yet. Certainly, I would put Utah higher than USC. The thing with USC, it's like the ceiling could be so high, right? I mean, that's what we're all hope. You know, if you're thinking all the stuff that they've done this offseason, the ceiling is so high. But of course, like they haven't been good for 5 years.
Well, they haven't been good for 5 years, and they've been terrible on the lines of scrimmage. And that's that's one area. You can add to your secondary and receiver core and your quarterbacks in the portal, but you can't really build your line of scrimmages, your offensive and defensive lines, rebuild those in the portal. And you can't rebuild a mindset and a toughness mindset. That's why I think it's a great hire. And I think SC, I don't think they're going to win 4 games. I think Lincoln Riley will be good. But to think they're going to go from 4-8 to like 10 or 11 wins next year, I just think that's like trying to hit on an 18 parlay.
Yeah, it's really hard to do. And I think, like, you know, I'm not an expert on recruiting or anything, but I think that there's like more like foundational or structural issues in terms of offensive line and line play in general. I think specifically we're talking about offensive line here, like that Southern California is just having issues producing linemen, right? And he was able to go get some of these Oklahoma, Texas players to become Sooners. And they were, I mean, we're talking about an offensive line that was top 5 in the country for, you know, 3, 4, 5 straight years. That's a big jump, like you said, to go from what USC has had for the past 5 years. So I agree with you. It's scary if you're thinking about it from a low-end perspective with USC, because if they don't fix the offensive line, then they're going to have problems.
Well, yeah, I mean, you said 3, 4, 5 years. 3, 4, 5, or 6 decades. I mean, look at the Pro Football and College Football Hall of Fames and look at the number of offensive linemen that USC has in there. Some of the greatest linemen in the history of the game college and pro, went to USC. Their big problem, and we've talked about it out here, Seth, is they've gotten away from who they were for all those years. They've tried to get cute and go five wides and spread. That's not who USC was. Their identity was always, you know, we're going to have the biggest, baddest offensive line, and we're going to run the ball, and then we're going to play action you and beat you deep with bombs. And they've gotten away from that. And I think if they get back to that, they could be really good again.
Right, but I wish there'd be more research on this stuff, but like, I, you know, you hear about the issues that high school football has in Southern California of producing high-end offensive line prospects for USC, right? Where you're not having this type of problem, certainly in the Southeast or even, you know, in the Midwest and the Ohios and the Michigan, where you're not getting these type of players available for USC. So now it's like a never-ending cycle of them not saying, okay, well, you know, can we be the team that we want to be? Maybe not, because we're not getting those players in. And then you end up in this cycle where everyone sees you as this 5-wide team and you can't transition out of it even if you do get good players.
By the way, should I start calling him Tony when he comes on the show with me?
Yes, please, please. I think I'm the only person who calls him Tony.
So. Oh, good. Then I am most definitely going to call him Tony moving forward here. That is awesome, because he'll be like, wait a minute, did Galena tell you to call me Tony? So Anthony Tresh will now be Tony Tresh moving forward.
Yes.
Okay.
If I can get everyone to start calling him that, that'll be a job well done for me.
All right, good news there. We're 9 days away from the draft. You wouldn't reveal. You made me wait like 4 days after we talked last to find out who your AFC West mock draft was. And I've got to say, your mock draft, I could tell you, since I've run about 3,000 different Pro Football Focus mock drafts, I think I had the same one you did once or twice. And I don't mind that for my Kansas City Chiefs. I kind of like that that 3-round mock that you ran for my guys. Heavy on defense, which they need. Rush and corner, which they need. And a good wide receiver thrown in there. I'm not upset about that. But as I texted you the other day, I'm still not convinced. I think with 12 first round, 12 picks overall and so many early, I think Veach is going to try his best to package maybe a first and a third and try and move up and grab somebody maybe even more impactful.
Yeah, I think, you know, generally you're not thinking, hey, the best move is to move up. But when you have all those picks and you're not like, you know, if you're the Jets and you have 6 picks in the first 3 rounds, or you're, you know, one of these types of teams, then I'd say, you know, hold on to them, go get a bunch of players. If 3 of them work out, great. But the Chiefs are in a different position, obviously. Now they're thinking, well, you know, we're not that far away from going back to the Super Bowl. We're an overtime away from going back to the Super Bowl. So I could see them really trying to figure out the best moves to package picks and move up for a player that they really like, whether that's an edge rusher or a receiver or someone like that. So, yeah, because of where they are in their team building, I think I could see them moving up for sure.
I would ask you, because I go back and forth on this, and I promise, folks, this is not going to be all Chiefs talk. We're going to move on to a few other things with Seth here in a second. But I go back and forth because there's so many good edge rushers and so many good wide receivers here. If they moved up, if I was Brett Veach and Andy Reid, I would wait and say, okay, maybe I move up and swap with the Eagles. They've got 2 first round picks, whether it's the 18 and the 15 or the whatever it might be. And I would say, here are the guys I like. And if this edge rusher's there or if this wide receiver's here, this is the way I would go. But I go back and forth on whether I would go wide receiver or edge rusher. If you're moving up in your Kansas City and you're going to get into the teens, do you go edge rusher or do you go wide receiver?
I think that it's going to depend on how the draft shakes out at that position, because I think you can get a tier one receiver in the teens. But I don't know if you can get a tier one edge in the teens. I think it's very possible that group of edges goes in the top 10, top 12 And then you're thinking, oh, now we might have a bit of a problem here. So then it's like, do you go and get like an Arnold Ebiketie? Like, hey, sure, that would be awesome for them. But I think if you're going to do that, it's really based on how the draft shakes out as we kind of go through it. Now, all of a sudden, if you see a George Karlaftis start to fall, you know, you're getting to pick 10, 11, maybe you think of pulling the trigger there to get one of the tier one edge guys. If not, then it's like, well, the tier two guys for me are all, you know, late first round, second round, you know, designated pass rusher types. So it's like, well, might as well just wait for them. And then you still have your two picks, right? And you can still go and get a receiver who we know there's going to be a glut of them at that range too. So to me, it really depends on how the draft is playing out if you really want to go and find that edge rusher.
With so many teams, Seth Galina with us from Pro Football Focus, so many teams having multiple first round picks, the Jets, the Eagles, now the Saints. Your Saints have done it too. The Chiefs, the Packers. Do you expect draft day, especially day one, and maybe even day two as well, but especially day one, it's going to be really active where a lot of teams are trying to move up? And do you anticipate teams maybe trading back a little bit too?
I was thinking about the Panthers today. They're and the Falcons, because I was doing the NFC South today. And like, man, you're talking about trade back candidates. It's those two teams, because you're two teams that need quarterbacks, but like, are you going to pick a quarterback in top 10 in this year's draft? Like, I don't know. And especially Carolina, like Carolina has no other picks in the top three rounds. They have six and that's it. So number six and that's it. So, you know, like if you feel that highly about Kenny Pickett and obviously a position of need that they have a quarterback, then okay, sure, whatever. Like your evaluation is as good as mine, but if I'm them, I'm saying, wait, I could trade back, still get a quarterback that people think is a tier one prospect. Because this tier one group of quarterbacks, like the five of them, it's so jumbled. One guy has Kenny Pickett as his number one. One guy has Sam Howell as number one. One guy has Desmond Ridder as number one. So it's like, you know, sit back, trade back if you're the Panthers, get a pick in the third round, second round, whatever, and then, you know, you still have the ability to go take a tier one quarterback. And again, this tier one group of quarterbacks is not the tier one group from last year, but still, I mean, you know, it's a group that's pretty interesting. I just pulled up some stats. Can I give you some stats about USC offensive linemen?
Yeah, absolutely.
So I'm looking at the past, 11 years now, since 2010. And so Tyron Smith, obviously, probably a future Hall of Famer, played at USC. But really, like with USC, it's like the interior of the offensive line. Since 2010, besides Ryan Khalil, I mean, Jeff Byers, Deuce Latuhi, Khaled Holmes, Jordan Simmons, like these are not top players. And just in terms of PFF grade, the only player besides Ryan Khalil with a PFF grade over 70 for a single season is Chilo Rochelle in 2010. So, like, they have just not produced interior offensive linemen for the NFL in a long time. Now, obviously, Elijah Vera Tucker, you know, he's a rookie last year. We'll see what happens with him. But, like, they have just not produced good offensive linemen, especially on the interior, in a long time.
And that's one of the reasons why Utah's been able to ascend, because their offensive line and defensive lines have always been really, really good. That was one area where they didn't really struggle when they made the transition from the Mountain West Conference to the Pac-12 Conference. Back to the pro side of things for just a minute. Where would most of these guys, if they were in last year's draft class, be second or third round draft picks? Would any of these guys be first rounders in last year's draft?
Sorry, you're talking the quarterback?
Yeah, the quarterbacks.
Yeah, I mean,
maybe at the very end?
Yeah, I would say probably at the very end. You know, in the same way that, like, Jordan Love went late in that draft 2 years ago, I would probably put them there. I think it's interesting to see where Malik Willis ends up, because I think, you know, you're going to have such wild evaluations of him. And I think even last year, a team could look at him and think of him as a top 10 pick. So that to me would be interesting, but I think generally all these guys are mid first to second round picks.
What do you think happens with Baker Mayfield? He's still sitting out there. There's no way Cleveland's going to keep him and pay him. There's got to be a market for him out there. He's not a great quarterback, but he's a good quarterback, and there's need for proven quarterbacks. Does somebody make a deal before now? And do you think he gets moved before draft day?
Before draft day, I don't see that happening. I think eventually, you know, obviously the Browns are going to have to just, you know, pinch their nose and add a draft pick to wherever he's going, because that seems like the only way you're going to move that him and the contract. The Seattle was a destination last week, and then it seems like right after he went on some podcast and said that he thinks Seattle would be cool for him, they went out and signed Geno Smith. So that's not seems to be happening. Carolina, I think, said last month that wouldn't be happening. They're still, you know, have availabilities there. Atlanta, maybe, but they signed Marcus Mariota. So I don't know, man. Like, right now, there's just not – the musical chairs, the music has almost stopped here, and he's got no place to sit. Now, again, if Deshaun Watson is suspended this season, though it seems like he might not be suspended this season at all, to tell you the truth. But if he's suspended this season, then – he's going to play somewhere with the Browns.
We'll talk next week before the draft, but do you still feel good about Devin Lloyd, local guy, being a top 20, top 21, 22 pick?
Yeah, I think so, 100%. You know, it's going to be interesting, obviously, positional value linebackers, but I think he's so versatile, and I think he plays the game in the way that teams kind of want their linebackers to play at the next in the future of the NFL, that I think he's still going to be a top pick.
Tell them where they can get your stuff, Seth, your 3-round mocks, and some of Tony Tresh's stuff, too.
PFF.com and PFF underscore Seth and PFF underscore Anthony.
Not Tony. You'll have to go with Anthony.
Yeah, I'm going to make him change it, though. That's the thing. Once we get him to change it on Twitter, then it's official.
By the way, you buried the lead. 50% off right now on a yearly subscription by using the promo code DRAFT50.
50% off on your yearly subscription when you use the promo code DRAFT50 on PFF.com. Thank you for reminding me.
Don't worry. I won't tell Collinsworth you forgot. Thanks, Seth. I'll talk to you next week.
All right.
There you go. Seth Galina with us from Pro Football Focus today here on the Bill Riley Show on ESPN 700.
On a cold February morning in Indianapolis, Tony Kuritsis woke up, got dressed, loaded his sawed-off shotgun, and drove to his bank. He wasn't there to steal anything. He was there to take his life back. American Hostage is a new podcast starring me, John Hamm, that tells the true story of one man who channeled the rage of a nation and took justice into his own hands. Follow American Hostage wherever you get your podcasts, or you can binge all 8 episodes right now on Amazon Music or Wondery Plus.
There are more ways to celebrate than ever before at the Jeep Celebration event. Hurry in for great deals today on the only brand that lets you go anywhere and do anything. And now, financing get $2,500 total cash allowance on the purchase of a 2022 Jeep Grand Cherokee WK Laredo 4x4. Don't miss this great offer. Hurry into the Jeep Celebration event today. Financing for qualified buyers through Chrysler Capital. Not all buyers will qualify. Residency restrictions apply. Must take retail delivery by 5/2/22. Jeep is a registered trademark.